Okay. Let me introduce our next speaker to you, Dr. Amruta. She is she completed her graduation and post-graduation from KEM. She completed her post-graduation in 2008. She's had over 10 years of experience at our university. She completed her NDT certification in pediatrics in the year 2017, her master's in clinical psychology, a diploma certification in art-based therapy, and she has research publications in pediatric as well as adult physiotherapy to her credit. She was kind enough to keep her CV short for me. So I welcome you, ma'am. The stage is all yours.
So most of the people here I know are from pediatrics physiotherapy. So I think a lot of what I'll be covering today will be sort of known to you all, but we'll be probably reinforcing it or reiterating on what we already know. And then we'll try to also sort of integrate everything and then streamline it towards the topic of today's discussion, which is hip. Okay, so now that through the first lecture, we have already had an overview of what is cerebral palsy, in what way can we specifically diagnose cerebral palsy or what qualifies as CP. And then we had a run through the GMFCS several times. So then what are the objectives right now of my talk? Now that through Sir's lecture, we already know that the hip is at risk and what happens specifically at the hip joint. Why is the hip at risk in CP? And what should be our concern as therapists? So how is the postural and movement system and the dysfunction associated with it contributing to the risk of the hip joint? Why is the hip joint jeopardized in the first place as an impact of the changes that happen in the postural and movement systems? Because that should be our concern. In what way does the risk change with the type of CP? And how do the treatment strategies, the conventional treatment strategies that we use, have a direct or an indirect impact on hip health? So these will be the three main objectives of my talk today. So then just for 5 minutes, let's go through the way a normal child develops. Okay, so we all know now that the femur is supposed to have an antiversion of approximately 40 degrees at birth and an angle of inclination, the neck shaft angle of approximately 135 degrees at birth. And the child's hip, for a child with CP, the hip is normal at birth, right? So there's something to do with the postural movement system which puts the hip at risk. So then what is normal in the first place? So a child is usually, a typically developing child is born with a physiological flexion. The femur has an angle of antiversion of 30 to 40 degrees. And with movement in prone away from gravity, the angle of antiversion subsequently decreases. Okay, so this is physiological flexion. We know the attributes of physiological flexion. So let's go right from the top to the bottom. Let's not only look at the hip because we are concerned with the entire biomechanical chain, right? So the weight bearing is perioral. The scapulae are elevated. Okay, so the capital extensors and the cervical extensors are shortened. The shoulders are in the position of adduction internal rotation with the elbows being in flexion, the forearms being in pronation. There is a kyphotic spine. So right from the thorax down to the sacrum, it's a C-shaped curve. The hips are flexed, slightly abducted. You can see that the knees are flexed and the ankles are dorsiflexed. Now, as the child comes up against gravity, so that is probably the first 2 to 3 months, you see the weight shifting down gradually. Now, the weight shifts down slowly, gradually towards the lower part of the body, which is the hip, which is essential for the remodeling of the antiversion. And then later when the child starts assuming weight through the hip joint, correction of the coxa valga. Okay, so but for that to happen, initially it's essential that the baby is able to raise the upper body. Okay, so unless we look at the upper body, the way the rib cage changes its alignment or assumes or attains the adult-like alignment, we cannot really understand or will not be as therapists be able to impact the hip, because it all concerns or it all goes via the entire biomechanical chain. So the first thing that happens is that the child is able to appreciate the visual vertical perhaps, and so has the impetus to come up, pushes down through the forearms, is able to elongate the pectorals and the anterior chest wall, not only in prone but also in supine through all the movements that happen in the eliminating gravity plane. With that, the anterior chest wall opens. Only with that, the ribcage is able to come down or descend. Once the ribcage comes down, the muscles which take their origin from the ribcage, like the serratus anterior, are able to elongate. And once they elongate, they can activate. Okay, that is how the scapula comes back to the adult-like alignment. Once that happens, only when that happens, the thoracic spine can extend. So I think all of us can just do this. You probably know this, but let's just have an organic experience of this process. So let's elevate the scapula as much as you can. Okay, and then let's get the shoulders into internal rotation and adduction as much as you can. Okay, so the maximum range. And now try to extend the thoracic spine. It's not possible, right? So that is what happens when you're not able to first free this segment. So unless the scapulae descend and the shoulders come back to the neutral position, the thoracic spine cannot extend. And if the thoracic spine cannot extend, the weight cannot shift down to the hips. Okay, so unless we work on the ribcage, your hips cannot be impacted. So now this is the a later part, around maybe 4, 5, 6 months of age, 4 to 6 months, when the baby has the weight has shifted down to the hips. Actually, there the weight is somewhere at the thoracic level. Now it's at the lumbar and hip level. During this process, the anterior capsule, the hip capsule, and the Bigelow's ligament are responsible in pushing the head of the femur behind, and this is what causes remodeling of the antiversion. And so the angle comes back to, or the angle of torsion or antiversion reduces to around 15 degrees slowly through the course of the first year. And now here the baby has started shifting weight also. Okay, so there you see a lot of co-activation and the glutei beginning to fire, and here you have the graded activation also of the glutei of the two sides as the baby is learning to shift weight. Okay, so antiversion of the femur reduces in response to the stresses applied to the proximal femur by the anterior capsule. This is possible because of the gradual shift of weight towards the lower body. Just to repeat, made possible due to elongation of the anterior chest wall and the pectorals, descent of the ribcage, descent of the scapulae, and extension in the thoracic and lumbar spine. After this, the baby comes to sitting, starts shifting weight. There is a gradual narrowing of the base of support with graded control. All these are necessary because this is how the glutei start firing in different positions. Then the weight shifts in standing, which evolve from being more lateral to being diagonal. And then the baby starts walking, first with a wider base of support, then to a narrower base, and then from lateral to diagonal weight shifts. So what's happening here is the hip is getting subjected to compressive stresses in different ways. It's not only one part of the hip which is receiving the greatest compressive stress. So that's just one part of the story. So as the weight bearing through the hip joint increases because of optimal co-activation of the postural muscles, particularly the glutei, and there is graded control of pelvis on femur in various weight bearing situations like creeping, crawling, kneeling, cruising, walking, there is decrease in the angle of inclination. There is increased concavity of the acetabulum itself, and there is a uniform distribution of the compressive forces through the hip joint. So then, why is the hip at risk in a child with cerebral palsy? We know that it is at risk and it's susceptible to subluxation, but then what is it about the muscle work? Okay, so one thing, there is inadequate remodeling of the hip, particularly antiversion and inclination, due to dysfunction in the postural and movement systems. So the antiversion, which is fetal, is not getting remodeled. That's one aspect to be remembered. But also the abnormal forces subject themselves onto the femur in such a way that the antiversion can actually increase. Okay, so there can be further instability precipitated because of the movement dysfunction. So just to go through the chain of events, there is altered neurological activity, imbalance of muscle activity, predominance of tone in the hip flexors and adductors, usually that is the dystonic or the hypertonic category, decreased range of hip extension, abnormal force application to two areas. One, the femur, because of which there is retained or increased fetal antiversion and coxa valga, and to the acetabulum, leading to decreased anterolateral growth of the acetabulum. We'll be looking at the picture. So now the three hips that you're seeing here, the first one, the one on your left, that's the normal one. Okay, so there is a balanced activation of the hip abductors, the hip flexors and the adductors. So the adductors are coming from the pubic symphysis, the inferior pubic ramus. The flexors are coming from the lumbar spine and inserting onto the lesser trochanter. Okay, so the abductors which insert into the greater trochanter, the adductors insert into the medial part of the femur, and the hip flexors, which are the iliacus and the psoas major, they insert into the lesser trochanter. So now all we know the composition of forces, right? So all three of them, if they act adequately, if they co-activate, that is when the femur or the center of the femur can actually get contained within the acetabulum. And so the compressive stresses then will be uniform throughout the contour of the acetabulum. Okay, so that's how the hip gets remodeled, really. Now what happens in CP? Already there is an angle of inclination. There are weak abductors. The flexor tone is on a higher side. The physiological flexion is also on a higher side to begin with. And that has not been corrected because the muscles have not got elongated. So now what will happen then is the adductors and the flexors will continue to apply their stresses. But now rather than there being a uniform compressive stress, this will act more like a steering mechanism, if you realize. Because this force is now too great and the angle of inclination is greater. So the force will cause the bone to move upwards. And there will be greater compressive stress on the upper lateral part of the acetabulum and the medial part of the femoral head. Okay, so this is the only area which receives all the compressive stress. And now any activity whatsoever of the abductors will only cause more superior subluxation rather than containment. Okay, and so then at one point there is a complete, almost a dislocation. Now, there is this liver arm dysfunction in cerebral palsy. There are various liver arm dysfunctions, but I've just picked up the ones which are usually associated with the hip joint. Okay, so there are also few more like flexible liver arm and the positional faults, but these three are ones which where you see examples of something going wrong at the hip joint. Okay, so you have a shortened liver arm, a malrotated liver arm, and an unstable fulcrum. We all know the basic concept of a liver. A liver has a fulcrum in between. There's a weight arm and the effort arm. So the effort into effort arm is equal to weight into weight arm. So the effort arm reduces. There is a mechanical disadvantage faced by the muscle because of which the effort generated by the muscle has to be increased. Okay, so that's basically the concept of a liver. Now a shortened liver arm of hip abductors in coxa valga. So coxa valga is increase in the angle of inclination. So here, the hip abductors suffer from a mechanical disadvantage. So what's happening here, when we are talking about the effort arm, we are looking at the perpendicular distance between the point of insertion of the muscle and the fulcrum. Okay, so this is a normal hip and this will be the distance between the fulcrum and the effort, right? And this is a hip which has increased angle of inclination. So automatically there is a shortening. Okay, because this is shortened, the amount of effort which is required to be generated by the abductors to maintain the weight on that limb will be greater, and as it is, there is a neuromuscular impairment, which is weakness of the abductor, so the person cannot sustain. Okay, this is another example where you actually have a shortening of the neck of the femur. So that's another condition altogether. So then what does the child commonly do? Because we have the formula, weight into weight arm is equal to effort into effort arm. So here the effort arm has reduced. So either the effort can increase or the child will do something to reduce the weight arm. That is what the child is doing here. Okay, so she's trying to get the center of gravity closer to the hip joint. Okay, by moving the HAT, the head, arm and trunk segment towards the hip. Okay, that's what she's doing. But in the process, you know what is happening. There's a shortened weight shift. A weight shift is supposed to be lengthened for it to be effective and for it to be energy efficient, both. So when you're doing a lengthened weight shift, that's when you're recruiting the real postural muscles which have a capacity for endurance, a capacity to continue working for a longer period of time. And it's also effective because you can genuinely shift your weight. Also in the process, you end up creating a smooth transition of the COG and maintain your balance better, which is not happening here. have a malrotated liver. Now this is seen when you have a retained antiversion. Okay, so now this is a normal hip again. Okay, now though this is antiversion, now there are two things happening here. It's called as a malrotated liver. Though the liver is also getting shortened, we call it malrotated because it has two types of impacts. One, that the actual effort arm is getting reduced in this situation because it's the perpendicular distance that you're looking at. Okay, so here this is the distance. So if there is an antiversion, the distance is only so much. Okay, so the actual distance has reduced, so there is a shortened liver. But in addition to that, you have to also realize that the origin of the gluteus medius is here. Okay, and the insertion is here. So the lateral alignment of the gluteus medius that you were seeing here is now going posterolateral. So it's no longer behaving like an abductor, it's behaving like an extensor and also like an internal rotator actually. It creates an internal rotation torque. Because of this, the antiversion further increases. So not only that the antiversion is not getting remodeled, rather it's getting exacerbated because of the pull of the gluteus medius whenever it acts, whatever extent it acts. Okay, so again, to summarize this point, decrease in the length of the gluteus medius leading to mechanical disadvantage, change in the alignment of the gluteus medius, so it acts like an extensor and internal rotator. This leads to further increase in the antiversion. Now the unstable fulcrum. Okay, an unstable fulcrum is basically the center of the femur being unstable. So here you have bilaterally you can see this is a relatively normal femur which is properly contained within the acetabulum, and here you have a femur where part of it is outside the acetabular containment. So here any kind of work which is happening here, probably the effort arm is not greatly reduced, okay, but because it's already out, there will be no single point or pivot around which the muscle can act. So in that sense, it's a different kind of an impairment. It's not only because of shortening of the liver arm, but because the point around which the movements are happening is not stable. So any force which is generated creates more and more of instability. Okay, so there is no single point of anchorage around which the weight bearing or movements can happen. So when the hip is already displaced, there is no stable fulcrum around which the abductor force can be created. The abductor force then pulls the unstable femoral head upward and causes further subluxation. Okay. Now we'll be looking at the types of CP, which we sort of know. But the effect of postural movement dysfunction on hip in different types of CP. So these are basically the types. The hypertonic type, we don't call it only spastic. We know the reason why, because it's not just the velocity dependent increase in the stretch reflexes, but also the hypertonia, which comes from multiple origins. Okay, it's a multi-system disorder. So it can have its basis in the muscle itself. It can have its basis in the fact that the child is trying to activate the movement muscles or the phasic muscles for the sake of stability. It can be a position dependent increase in tone. Okay, so generally it's called as hypertonia. Within which you have then the topographical classification of quadriplegia, hemiplegia, diplegia. Then the dyskinetic type, within which we see a big population of dystonia and then athetosis. The ataxic type and the hypotonic type. Hypotonic type, as we heard from Sir Shekhar Patil Sir in the beginning, it's not something which we see throughout the life. It's something which we probably see for the first 1.5 years or so, and then it evolves into another kind of CP. You start seeing the signs of ataxia and athetosis, dystonia a little later. Okay, but during that 1.5 years or the earlier phase, the child presents to you with hypotonia. So we have to look at the postural movement dysfunction during that phase also. So you have to really consider that. Okay, so now within the hypertonic type, we mainly have the three categories. Now, what are the features of hypertonic cerebral palsy that can impact the hip joint directly? Okay, so here there is decreased ability to co-activate, which means initiate and then sustain the activity in the postural muscles, and there is excessive activation in the muscles which are biarticular, phasic and superficial. So these are actually three different classes of muscles, but most of the muscles in the body fall in almost all three of these categories. So this includes mainly your pectorals, your biceps, latissimus dorsi, the rectus abdominis, rectus femoris, hamstrings, gastrocnemius, the long finger flexors, pronator teres. Okay, typically all the muscles which go into overactivity for the sake of stability sometimes. So in the seated posture, normally, typically, you see a kyphotic thoracic spine. With this, there is altered orientation of the rectus abdominis. Okay, now a rectus abdominis, by its anatomical name, is supposed to be a rectus. It's supposed to be something which aligns your spine straight, keeps it straight. Okay, but if the spine is kyphotic, it's not been able to extend at all. Also because of the orientation of the ribcage, and we know that the rectus abdominis originates from the ziphy sternum, inserts into the pubic symphysis. So if the orientation of the spine and the ribcage is gone for a toss, then automatically the rectus starts behaving more like an obliquus. So it creates more of a rotatory torque, further increasing the kyphosis. Okay, so that's one thing. Then the second thing that happens is the hamstrings are overactive, which pull the overactive or shorted, which pull the pelvis behind. Now in such a situation, the child tries to actually align himself, making use of the hip flexors. But then what happens is the hip flexor activation and the extension of the spine as a whole, of the trunk as a whole, is not possible because that requires a lot of selective graded control. It's kind of an anti-pattern. There is flexion at one joint and extension at the trunk. So what, on the contrary, what happens is the hip flexors get activated along with the hamstrings. And so the thigh raises off the surface, pushing the child further behind. Okay, so there is more of sacral sitting. So that's typically what you see. When you take this child into standing, now you have done two things. You have reduced the base of support and you have increased the center of gravity. So here there is again an increase in activity of the hip flexors, the adductors, plantar flexors, shoulder internal rotators, adductors, scapular elevators. Okay, and this happens more when you take the child into a challenging position. Now, as the scapulae are elevated and the shoulders remain in internal rotation and adduction, the thoracic mobility reduces. Okay, so there is increased difficulty in activating the postural muscles. Now, why does this really happen? We saw that we cannot extend the thoracic spine, or the mobility of the thoracic spine reduces, but the thoracic spine and the ribcage are connected basically with all the other postural muscles. So your obliques take their origin from the ribcage. So unless the ribcage descends, there cannot be an elongation of the obliques. If they are not elongated, they cannot align and then activate. Okay. So on the contrary, for the sake of stability, there will be overfiring of some muscles. The child has to have some muscles to hang on there. And those happen to be the muscles which are the phasic muscles or the movement muscles. One thing, these movement muscles further take the child into a compromising awkward position, okay, from where graded controls are not possible. And secondly, these muscles are not equipped for a sustained activity, so the child ends up spending much more energy in the process. So it's not an energy efficient strategy either. Now in diaplegia, typically in diaplegia, you see certain postures, certain attitudes, which we are all very aware of. A W sitting with a narrow base of support. Now, a W sitting that you see in a child with spastic diaplegia is slightly different from what you see in a child with hypotonic or athetoid type of CP. They also W sit. But the only difference being that a child with spastic diaplegia W sits with the femurs being anterior. They create an anterior base of support because the adductor tone is more. And so they assume a kyphotic posture so that the COG remains within this new base of support. Okay, on the contrary, a child with athetosis will have a wider base of support with W sitting, and so actually the base of support goes more posterolateral. So it's like a flared, the thighs are flared apart, and so the child extends and just with the help of the musculoskeletal structures will just hang on there posteriorly. Okay. Again, as I said, the ribcage is elevated with decreased activation of the abdominals. This changes the orientation of the diaphragm. It starts acting as a stability muscle in an inclined orientation. So just like the rectus abdominis, the diaphragm has also now changed its orientation. Okay, so the diaphragm, which is meant to be the main primary muscle of respiration, is now, its orientation is changed, and it's also in a state of mechanical disadvantage because it's already in a shortened position. So it starts behaving like a stability muscle. Further, what it does, we'll just see. Okay, so the diaphragm has got a central tendon which inserts into the lumbar vertebral bodies. The psoas major also originates from the lumbar spine. there's a mistake there. It originates from the lumbar spine, inserts into the lesser trochanter. Now both of these will pull onto the lumbar spine. Okay, so both of these have their attachments in the lumbar spine, and so they create their pull. The diaphragm from above and the psoas from a lower area. And so the lumbar spine gets pulled anteriorly, and that is one thing which leads to this kind of a posture. Okay, here the child is trying to maintain the COG within the newly acquired base of support with the stick. Okay, but it's also because of this mechanism where the diaphragm and the psoas are pulling the lumbar spine anteriorly. So this causes the lumbar spine to be in extension. A sudden change in orientation of facets from thoracic to lumbar is another reason why there is excessive mobility at that junction. Okay, there will be shortening of the iliacus and weakness of the glutei and abdominals, which causes the pelvis to remain tilted anteriorly. Okay, so basically we have to consider the whole thing. It's not, yes, definitely the glutei are underactive, the hip flexors are shortened, there's a change in orientation of the pelvis. But why is all this really happening? Because right from above, the co-activation is not happening. Okay, there are biomechanical stresses being applied inappropriately at every level. Now, if you look at the weight shifts in a child with diplegia, normally in a typical development, a weight shift is supposed to be initiated from the base of support. Right? There are APAs, but then the weight shift is initiated from the base of support. Now here the initiation of the weight shift happens from the upper body, and the excessive mobility between the thoracic spine and the lumbar spine allows this to happen. So they actually make use of the excessive mobility and just throw their upper spine on one side and create the weight shift. So there is absence of lengthened weight shift. Because the lengthened weight shifts are not available, this is an indication of lack of activity of the hip abductors, which are required to stabilize the hip joint. Now hemiplegia. In hemiplegia, we know that there is a certain kind of attitude that you see, but in hemiplegic CP, there are three types of presentations which are theoretically noted. So either the child uses strong internal rotation with slight hip flexion, knee flexion, plantar flexion with pelvic elevation. Okay, so there is pelvic elevation that you see on the left side with an adduction internal rotation, hip flexion, knee flexion, and plantar flexion. Okay, so that's one thing. That's one kind of presentation. There is another kind of presentation. This is a child with right-sided hemiparesis, hemiplegia. Okay, so this child is leaning down towards the hemiplegic side. So there's a drop in the pelvis rather than an elevation. Okay, so this can also happen. Her hip and knee are slightly flexed and the hip is externally rotated. Now, this is typically seen in a child who, besides having the motor impairments, also has sensory impairments. So the joint position sense itself is lacking is the reason why they say that this kind of a presentation is seen commonly. And then you have this kind of a picture where there is shortening of the trunk on the side of hemiplegia with excessive thoracolumbar extension, and there is hip hyperextension. So the hip hyperextension normally is seen because the first contact happens at the forefoot. Okay, and so the joint, the ground reaction force happens to fall anterior to the knee joint, throwing the knee into hyperextension, and also because the because of weakness of the pre-tibial muscles. Okay, so now when it comes to hypertonia, what are the basic strategies that we normally employ, which can have a direct and an indirect impact on the hip joint? So the first principle to be remembered is respect the whole biomechanical chain, as we said. So work on elongation, direct and active, of all the shortened muscles, starting with the ribcage. So the pectorals, the anterior chest wall, get the ribcage to move. Work on ribcage mobility in order to allow activation of the core muscles. With the activation of the core muscles, there will be lengthened weight shifts available in sitting and standing. And to allow weight acceptance and graded controls in gait and transfer. So it will move in that order, essentially. Okay, so to activate the trunk after achieving the requisite elongation and alignment, this kind of these are the equipments that we commonly choose, right? So a movable surface is something which will allow the weight shifts to happen, and it will also ensure that the adequate base of support is created, okay, which will be both large enough for weight acceptance as well as small enough for the base to be active. So it should not be too wide, cannot be too narrow. So to encourage activation with graded weight shifts, with gradual loading of weight-bearing side. These arrows, these pictures are from Stamer. I think most of you must have gone through Stamer, Marcia Stamer. So, the reason I've put these pictures here, though we have gone through these pictures in the past, in what way are we impacting the hip here? So, while after getting the entire upper body aligned, we are giving a compression through the femur and then we are giving a weight shift. So, the compressive stresses are gradually getting generated there. As I have already spoken about the rib cage and the upper body mobility, before you go for the transfers or before you train for a functional activity in the peripersonal space, getting the trunk activated in the diagonal patterns for functional activity is very important. And for that, first working on the mobility of the thoracic spine and then trying to generate as much of active mobility in the thoracic spine as possible. This prepares the system for graded weight shifts, and this can be a precursor for transfers also. So this child could be trained for any activity in her peripersonal space this way. And so the rotations can be facilitated, but this can also work for certain weight acceptance later. Facilitation to promote hip knee extension in weight bearing and to promote trunk rotation for weight acceptance in stance. So here you can see in the first picture, you can see the therapist making sure that her hands are basically on the glutei, creating an external rotation, compression towards, it's an input basically. And then there is also, what she's also trying to do is, she's trying to generate a graded control of the trunk on the femur, which is the left, on the left side. So it's the graded control that she's basically training. And in the second diagram, you can see her giving a compression downwards, keeping the femur in external rotation. So in the second one, the child is getting ready for the basic coactivation and assumption of weight on the lower extremity. And here goes the next step, which is taking a step or assuming weight and then taking the next step. Now, when it comes to this category of CP, athetoid dystonic type, the main difference between a hypertonic and athetoid type of CP when it comes to the hip joint is that in the athetoid category, there are greater chances of the hip getting subluxated anteriorly rather than posteriorly. Because you sometimes see the internal rotation adduction, but a lot of times you see them pushing down and raising the pelvis up. Okay, you will see a lot of these kids pushing down and raising the pelvis. If it happens, both the hip joints anteriorly are geopardized. So there can be chances of anterior subluxation, but sometimes it's in an asymmetrical pattern. Okay, there's a lot of asymmetry that you see in athetosis. So it's quite possible that the anterior subluxation may be seen on one side and the posterior subluxation or displacement may be seen on the other side. So sometimes there can be, you can see the hip getting displaced anteriorly on one side, posteriorly on the other side. And this is usually initiated by the excessive activity in the cervical and lumbar extensors. Okay, so it's generated by the cervical and lumbar extensors in various positions. So you see this happening in supine, you see this happening in sitting, standing, okay, various positions. So here you can clearly see the right hip being pushed down. You can see the child pushing the head down back towards the supporting surface. You can see the lumbar spine going into extension and you can see the other hip going into internal rotation and flexion. Okay, so the right hip is susceptible to an anterior subluxation here, whereas the left hip is susceptible to a posterior subluxation. Now, the strategies which are usually employed for dyskinetic CP, the one thing which is usually very strongly prescribed is you have to load the child. Okay, so loading of the feet is something which regulates the child. It creates a good input through the body. It's a regulatory input. There will be rotatory movements seen in all segments, but these are found to decrease the moment you gradually load the extremities. There is a gradual compression through the axial skeleton. When you're loading the lower extremities, it's also important that the upper extremities receive some kind of a compression as well. But one thing again to be remembered in athetoid CP is there are triggers, there are typical triggers which tend to throw the child back into those athetoid postures. So one thing is the hard surface. I think almost all of us have experienced this, that when the child comes in contact with a hard surface, whether it's a wooden stool or it's when the child is taking weight on the floor for the first time, that is when the child goes into those postures. So far as possible, softer equipments should be used. Now, this directly may not sound like it's associated with the hip joint, which is the topic of discussion, but you know, these are all triggers which make the child go into those postures, and those postures are making the child susceptible to hip displacements. So be careful about the equipment which is chosen. Now, besides the typical NDT techniques which are used, there are certain cognitive strategies which definitely need to be used in order to contain the child in the session. Because again, the one thing which is very prominent about a child with dyskinetic type of CP is that they are cognitively good. So we shouldn't allow the cognition to be an area of vulnerability. We should not allow the cognition to be so much faster than the physical domain that there is a thought action fusion and the child doesn't know what to do or gets disarrayed because the thought is running much faster than the body or gets frustrated because of the repeated failed attempts to do something. And so goes more and more into those postures. Okay, so we have to design the session in such a way that the child is able to stay within the session. So the preparatory phase, the simulation phase, and the functional phase should be seamlessly connected to each other. The child should not feel like there's a patch getting added to the session. So it should be like a narrative which you can build. So give opportunities for creativity while maintaining a closed context to work in. This can regulate the child and prevent the overfiring, which is again the main thing that you want to avoid. And then the last type of CP, which is the hypotonic ataxic cerebral palsy. Now, this is not really the category in which you see a lot of subluxations, because usually the child sits with a wider base of support. What the child cannot have is an effective, active base of support. But because this topic is about enhancing hip health and not just preventing dysfunction, I think we should just consider the basic things which we should be mindful of so that the hip health can be enhanced or so that the coactivation around the hip can be made a little better. So usually this child sits, stands and walks with a wide base of support. The ataxic type and the small group of hypotonic kids that we see. So there's external rotation and abduction of hips in standing. In ataxia, sometimes there can be co-contraction of the hip flexors and knee flexors also to lower the center of gravity. It's sometimes a stability strategy that they adopt. Okay. So one thing is that you can give them compression garments. Now these are supposed to enhance the proprioceptive inputs through the system during maintenance of posture and in movement. Use the visual system in training balance strategies. So of all the three main systems which contribute to sensory systems which contribute to your balance, visual, vestibular and proprioceptive, visual is supposed to be the one which they use the most for the sake of stability. So the visual system can be made use of, but you have to just increase the repertoire of the visual system and try to work on strategies which can get the child to take the gaze down. So this is something which will make them co-activate the muscles, get into some of the diagonal patterns, and once these patterns come in, then it's possible that the child will want to reduce the base of support. Because unless the child is habituated as well as sensitized to those cues, making use of the system which is friendly or which is accessible, the child will not want to reduce the base of support. The increased base of support is a stability strategy, so you directly cannot impact it. It will be indirectly, gradually, subsequently impacted. Okay. Then another thing to be remembered in ataxia, just the way in athetoid the cognition is supposed to be good and you can always leverage the cognition. In ataxia, these are the kids who, because of the severe perceptual problems that they have, because none of the sensory systems is giving them that frame of reference to which they can compare and correct or do the error correction. It gets very difficult for the child to learn, and it gets difficult for the child to extrapolate what they have learned from a situation to another situation. So transfer of training becomes very difficult. So anything that you are doing, whether it is to increase stability, to improve mobility, functional training, it has to be specific to what you want to achieve in the child. So you have to be very, very specific with a single function at a time. And that's how the child will be able to manage the best. Okay, or even reduce the base of support and get the postural muscles to co-activate better. So the gradual increase in awareness of the body through the functional activities can help reduce the pace of support, promote better co-activation of muscles around the hip. Now, Now, this is a study which I think was also mentioned in the previous talk. This was actually a systematic review which said that all interventions which are meant to design the positioning systems for the kids with CP, they are known to have an impact on the migration percentage or the increase of the migration percentage. So it was found to slow down the increase of the migration percentage over 5 years. But for this, almost all of the studies said that the hip abduction range, which is maintained by those positioning systems, should be at least 20 degrees. This angle achieves good femoral coverage within the acetabulum. In all of these studies, the postural support systems were used for more than 5 to 6 hours a day and for a period longer than 18 months. The usage time was found to be directly correlated with the level of control of the hip deformities. So this was from a journal, Neurologia, published in 2017. Now, these positioning systems mentioned in these studies have been in the form of hip abduction brace, the swash brace that sir had mentioned. A hip abduction plaster cast was also used in some of the studies, and a dynamic hip orthosis was also used. So what they found is that the dynamic systems worked better than the static systems when it came to slowing the progression of the migration percentage. And the results revealed decreased migration percentage through 5 years. Okay, so, but the only hitch here was that the studies did not really specifically mention what type of CP it was. Most of the studies had a very wide age range. So going from 18 months to 16 years, that was also the span in some of the studies. So other than the specific protocol of the hours of maintaining the hip in that range, there was nothing much described when it came to the functional diagnosis of the child. So then to summarize, a child with CP is born with a normal hip joint, which may not be remodeled correctly through the course of development. It is essential to pay attention to the functional diagnosis specific to the form of CP, to understand the way in which the hip is jeopardized, and strategies to enhance hip health should be specific to the hip as well as holistic, considering the entire cognitive sensory motor profile. Okay. Thank you so much.